Jack and Nori, Jack and Nori, what's the story? Jack and Nori, the old man's story. There lived in the village of C a kind-hearted old man who was generally called Uncle John. The children loved to hear his stories, and many Wednesday afternoons sat upon the grass at his feet while he told about what he used to do when he was a boy. One of those stories of his I would tell to you. When he was about as high as you are now, said Uncle John, he was very fond of playing with gunpowder. Our old halfpence were carefully saved to buy the materials for making such fireworks that boys were able to do. I did this secretly, for my mother would never allow me to do it, so I married one. And one day, a gentleman came to visit my father. Among these other things, he asked me if I ever read a little book which he named. When I replied I had not, he gave me some money, saying I should like you to buy and read it. I wish he had given it to me to buy gunpowder, said I to myself as soon as he'd gone. For I knew well that no one was aware that I had money in my possession. It then occurred to me that I could still do it with it as I pleased. I bought a quantity of gunpowder and I was turning home with it. I met a boy about my own age and whom I often played. Come on, Harry, said I. But I've got a fine lot of powder. I want you to come with me this afternoon, and we have a real good sport. No, I cannot, said Henry. Why not? It is Saturday. There is no school this afternoon. Yes, I know that, he replied. But the truth is, John, my mother has such fears I shall get killed or hurt. I promise never to play with powder again. Oh, cried I. Is it always the way? Now I do think you might just this afternoon come and play with me. But it's no fun in playing alone. Come, you shall have half the powder for your own. Let me see it, said Henry. Well, he opened the brown paper and showed him the quantity I had brought. Oh, this is capital, said he. Yes, I will come just this once. We met in the afternoon and began to make squibs and crackers. We had made a few when Henry proposed we should get some fire and amuse ourselves by throwing powder into it. 2 grains at a time, Henry went for fire. While I went on with my work, I did not perceive that the paper which held the powder was a large hole. I was losing my treasure. It ran through to the ground. Irritated by this accident, I threw away the paper and sat down to wait for Henry's return. It came to me in a few moments. We must make haste, John, said he. We're here, for here comes a great troop of girls, and your sister Mary and your Lucy are among them. If they see us, they'll run home as fast as they can to tell tales of us. Well then, I answered, come help me scrape up this powder, which is all on the grass here, and we'll hide away the whole of it till they have gone. He knelt down and began to take the powder in our hands. John, said Henry, I get up the powder, and you go hide away those squibs among the bushes, and make haste, for I hear the girls, and they'll be here in a minute. Well, I caught up with the bundle of squids, we're running with them towards the cluster bushes. We heard a loud cry from Henry, and turning quickly, I saw the powder flashing in his eyes. In a moment, he had fallen forward into flame. As I nodded forward, a party of girls, pale and trembling, appeared among the trees. I shouted loudly for help. But how can I describe poor Henry as he lay down on the ground, his beautiful face blackened with powder and so shortly torn and mangled, he bore no resemblance to that of a human being? Is he hurt? Is he dead? Said the little girls, pressing around me. Who is he? Cried Lucy, throwing herself by his side. Is it not Henry? Oh, Henry, you will not say so, said she, looking in my face. I could only answer by cries and tears. Lucy raised her poor brother in her arms. Her face was perfectly calm, cold, while the rest of the children were drowned in tears and seemed not to think of doing anything to obtain help. In a few minutes, several men, who had been alarmed by the noise, came running towards us. Without asking questions, they took up the body gently. We followed them towards the house of his mother, whose last wishes I attempted Henry to cite. We saw him approach the door. We saw the poor widow sitting quietly at work. A neat little parlour, I cannot tell you, my children, said the old man, drawing his hand up before his eyes. Oh, sweet, her face changed, as a dreadful sight met her eyes. The same grave where they lay poor Henry was opened twice in 2 weeks, his mother's place by his side. The Lucy was left all alone in the world, till he was saying to my mother to take her nowhere else, and let me be her brother, in place of the one she had lost. I had spent my life in trying to make poor Lucy happy, and now, my dear children, you know why I so often urge you to obey your parents, be willing to do so as they wish. Why, none of you learned the importance of this, but it's a painful lesson as was mine.